Okay, anyway, chemistry of essential oils. This class is going to be different than any other class that you've had. It's going to involve not just the normal kind of lecture stuff that you're used to in other classes, but it's going to involve a smelling component, an odor identification component, which most of you probably have not experienced before. Who here is a chemistry major? Okay, most biochem. Okay. It's technically a third year chemistry class, but really if you've had any organic chemistry at all, you'll be fine in this class. It's not going to be a difficult class for science majors in particular, I don't think. At least the written part of the material. The smelling part is another aspect. And so if you look at the syllabus, the way I've divided the course up here, there's going to be a total of 1,000 points. About every other week or so, we're going to have a quiz. A written quiz, small written quiz, and then a small smell odor evaluation quiz, where you have to be able to identify individual components based upon just your smell alone. I have 50 points each for the written, 50 for the written, 50 for the smell test. That's going to be four of those types of quizzes, and then a midterm exam, which will be for 200 points. And the midterm exam will encompass all the chemistry sessions that we've had, plus odor identification of all the components. It would be very useful to have this kit. Now, these kits for the distance for the people taking this for the home study course sell for $499. It's got some expensive oils in there and individual isolates and things like that. It's 49 different 5 ml samples. I'm going to make it available to the students for half that price, at basically a cost, because I know students can't afford it. Now, if you don't want to buy the kit, that's fine. I'm not going to make you buy the kit. Our alternative would be I will have Sherry, who's going to be assisting me during this semester, bring in some bottles, and we can bring some of the GC vials in, and you can have just a tiny little sample vial of each one of the components. You'll have to label it and make, and you can take it home. This is going to be necessary to do this course because you're going to have to study these odors at home and to be able to familiarize yourself with them and be able to identify them on the quiz and on the test. If you don't do this and you come in and just try to take it, you're not going to pass. So that's a no-cost solution to it. But some people, I mean, a lot of people who are really into this field really want the kit. So it's your choice. It's a nice kit. It has, you know, it's a nice wooden box. Everything's labeled, and you get, you know, a little key that identifies all the components. So it saves you a little trouble having to make your little samples and all that. It's totally up to you. Just come to me later. Let me know if you want one or not. Next time we offer this, I'm going to have some kind of solution for the bookstore that will be a lower cost solution for students. So that covered the first half of the course. Once you get through exam one, is basically all the fundamental chemistry, essential oil chemistry. The second half of the course, we're going to be evaluating families of oils. As you can see there, we go through, I've grouped these into the basic classes of oils. Now, these aren't hard and fast rules. Other people will have other ways of classifying the groups of oils. These are my ways of classifying them after 17 years in the industry. I've got a good feel of, you know, how perfumers look at these things, as well as people that are in aromatherapy or other areas that are into this kind of stuff. So we're going to go through the mint oils, and I've chosen four oils from each group. Now there are many other oils in each group. Okay, don't get an idea that that's all there is in these groups, because there are hundreds of essential oils out there that you can theoretically distill. These are just some of the main ones, and this will get you a really good base foundation into the kind of mainstream oils that are out there. So we go through mint oils, citrus oils, floral oils, herb and spice oils, leaf and conifer oils, resin and wood oils, and then we will profile four different oils each week in a little detail so that you can become familiar with, you know, where are these oils grown, or where are these plants grown, how they're distilled, chemical properties of the individual oil. And you're going to have to become intimately familiar with each one of these oils, you know, to be able to pass the test, you know, in terms of what's its chemical makeup. I mean, not every tiny little chemical in there, but the main ones. Be able to identify it by odor. So that's a part of being able to smell these individual components. It's going to be very useful in your odor descriptors, because you're not going to have the language initially to be able to describe what you're smelling. So knowing the smells of the individual chemical components is going to give you that language. And when you smell the individual component, the main component from a particular oil, and then smell that oil, you're going to be able to say, oh yeah, I can see this component in here, but this is a lot more complicated than just that one component. But you'll be able to pick it out. Anyone here worried about smelling at all? Have a bad sense of smell? Like, think, ah, I can't smell at all. Okay, good. If you're a smoker, you're at a disadvantage. I'll just tell you that up front. But don't let that discourage you if you are, because most perfumers in the world are smokers, so, ironically. So at the end of all this is going to be a pretty interesting challenge, where I'm going to give each person their own unknown, which is going to basically be composed of one oil from each of these groups. And you're going to run it on the GC, and then based upon the chemical breakdown, try to tell me what the formula for this blend is. Okay, this is what a chemist in industry does a lot of, a perfumer chemist who would try to duplicate the formula. This is what they do. And it's like putting together a puzzle, because a lot of these oils have overlapping chemicals in common. So, for example, your citrus oils, all of them have a huge component of limonene, for example. So, if you see limonene in the sample, then you got to figure out, well, which citrus is this coming from? Or is it a combination of citrus? I'm not going to make it that complicated, but, you know, but each one of the citruses has their own characteristic minor components that will help you pick out which one it is. The only way you're going to be able to do this is by being familiar with the chemistry of that particular oil. So, and see, it may be a case of, you know, where there may be, let's say, linalool from, let's say, let's take alpha pinene. There's going to be some alpha pinene from, say, a mint component, and then alpha pinene from a leaf component, and they're both contributing to that alpha pinene. But based upon the other peaks, you can figure out how much of this one is contributing to that, how much of this other one is contributing. So it's literally like trying to put together pieces of a puzzle to figure this out. Just a little bit of CSI work for you, I guess you could say, because you will be using the same type of equipment. Who here has used a GC before? Chemistry, okay. Not that comp. You're not going to just be left on your own. We'll have someone to help you. Just basically, you don't even have to touch it, really. We've got an automatic sampler, robotic sampler, so it injects it for you and everything like that. So it's not a big deal. All you got to focus on is the output. Then you'll have your lecture final exam, which will encompass the last half of the course, plus you're building on the first half, so even though explicitly may not have the same kind of questions from the first half, the first half of the course is necessary for you to be able to fully understand the second half. You'll have an odor identification final, which is based upon just the essential oils themselves, not the individual components. I don't want to overload you with too much smelling at the end. And then 100 points for your answer on your unknown that you'll be given to analyze. And then, so that makes up 900 points. And then 100 points will be dedicated towards class participation. Now, there's not a lot, it's not a huge class, so I'll be able to know who's showing up, who's participating, who's not. This is a little different maybe than some of your other professors. I want you to interrupt me, okay? At any point in time, if I'm talking about something and you have a question about, stop me at that point, raise your hand, and let's get your question out of the way, because chances are somebody else might have the same question. I don't care about being interrupted. In fact, I require it, and I'm going to know, you know, based on, I'm going to make notes, basically, and the person who participates the most will get 100 points, down to, if you don't say anything, then that's a zero. But at some point, and you know, I'm going to expect you to be able to interact with the class, because it's going to enhance the class, make it more interesting for everybody and yourself if you do that. So it's a way to, you know, help your grade out if you choose to use it, or it could hurt you if you don't, because it's basically 10% of the grade. There's no required homework to turn in, but if you don't study at home, obviously you're not going to be able to do well on the test. Okay, any questions at this point? Okay. Well, so before I get into some of the history of this, who here can, has anyone here heard of an essential oil, the term essential oil, before you took this class or became exposed to this class, or me through some lecture or something like that? Who has never heard of an essential oil before basically this year? Okay. It's a lot better than when I was, I got my BA from here in 1990. I got through this, and I got through 5 years of grad school at University of Tennessee. Never heard the term essential oil. So you all are doing a lot better than I was. So the knowledge base out there is increasing. The people are becoming more exposed to this. The United States is a little further behind than the rest of the world in this. Europe especially is a lot more sophisticated in this area, because that's where modern perfumery really was birthed. So, you know, it's an overlooked area of chemistry in the United States, which is unfortunate, because it's probably the most lucrative area of chemistry that you could possibly be in. I don't know of a better area, to be honest with you, because if you're good at it, you're going to be in high demand. And part of the reason I'm even doing this class, I mean, I had one of my employees ask me, you know, Rob, why are you wasting your time teaching a class? It pays next to nothing, and you've got a million other things going on. Well, part of the reason is there's such a small pool of people to draw from, and I'm looking for someone that I can potentially mentor or take further down the road with this who has a real passion for it. Because my goal, I've accomplished just about everything I want to, except I want to create a handbook of essential oils that it's going to involve travel to a lot of different locations all over the world, to video and photo distillation, farming, and all that kind of stuff. Put it all together into the biggest, best compilation. This was done in the 50s and 60s by a guy named Gunther. It's very dated and very low tech, because the technology they had back then, you know, GC wasn't prevalent, and so they were shooting in the dark a lot of times with their identifications. There's a lot more stuff available right now. It has the potential to be the Bible for essential oils. But I'm getting older, I can't travel as much, I need help. How you doing? So that's part of the goal here. So with that in mind, let me find out who's here. I'm not going to mention people I know who are here, so. Okay, and of course he's here. Jamal Ritchie. Okay. Nathan Robertson. Okay. James Robinson. No? James Robinson not here? Okay, he's one of the ones who contacted me. Sarah Schmelz. Okay. Benjamin Spaulding, Christian Stadler, James Welsh. Okay. I didn't call you?
Sarah, actually.
Did you just add? Okay. Do you have to give this to me?
Or? Actually, Dr. Satterall gave you some other things I need to
do. Okay. All right, we'll take care of that after class. Okay. Anyone here not have Facebook? Are you opposed to Facebook? Okay. If you have Facebook, you will have an enhanced experience with the class, I think, because it will give you the opportunity to interact with me during any point prior to when we meet, to ask questions, put up stuff for conversation, whatever, put up pictures. Any topics relevant to essential oils, whatever. So I would encourage you to join the group. It's a closed group. So if you join it, you're not going to be giving away any information to anybody. This is not a public group. Only people that I authorize can join it. And I put the address on the syllabus. Who did not get a syllabus? Okay. Let me... I don't... Oh, is there some more there? Did you get one? Okay. Here, I got more. Do you need? You already have one? Okay. Okay. So if you go to right there next to my contact info, you'll see the address for the Facebook page. It would really benefit you to join that group. Also, I have a Facebook page for my company, Essential Oil University, which is just facebook.com/Essential Oil University. Would be a good idea to join that as well, because that will give you a feeling for kind of what's going on in the essential oil world. There's over 2,000 people now. I've only had this page up for a few months, and I've got like 2,000 likes now on this, over 2,000. And it's accelerating in the number of likes. I have that, and if you're on LinkedIn, I have a group on LinkedIn, Essential Oils group on LinkedIn, which has almost 3,000 now. So that would be another one to join. If you really are into this, those are very good places to kind of put your finger on the pulse of what's going on in the world of essential oils and aromatherapy, perfumery, you know, all that kind of stuff. Okay, so before you guys came in, I was discussing about, are you guys chemistry majors?
Yeah, biochemistry.
Okay, good. You don't have to be, really, to be able to do well in this class, but it helps, because I'm not going to cover a lot of the fundamental aspects of organic chemistry. It's not going to be hard if you had organic chemistry. That part's going to be pretty easy for you. Okay, this is not going to be like spectroscopy or anything like that. or even biochem, it's going to be a pretty laid back class. It's going to be as fun as you guys want to make it, because there's a lot of opportunity for interaction, discussion. As I told the rest of class already, I require that you interrupt me. Okay, I want to be interrupted when I'm up here. If I'm talking about a subject, you have a question, any question at all, raise your hand. I want to stop right there, answer the question. Because chances are somebody else has the question. So, and that's part of your participation grade. If you look over the syllabus, there's 1,000 points total. 100 points are reserved for your participation in the class. Okay, so that means how often you ask a question, how often you are here, present, you know, that kind of stuff. So you could get an A in the class if you never show up, if you get 100 on every test, which I can guarantee is not going to happen. So if you want an A, pretty much you're going to have to participate in class. And that's going to be to your, you know, that's going to be to your benefit too, because this isn't just about books and that kind of learning. This is hopefully going to be, I would say at least one person in here is going to have a profound life change as a result of this class. They are going to be exposed to a field that they would have never been exposed to before, and that's not because of me, but I'm just saying, you're not going to be exposed to this kind of stuff in southern Indiana. It's just not available. And it just happens because I live here, that's why it's here. So it is an area that if you get passionate about, will be, like I was telling the class earlier, very lucrative area to be in. I don't know of a better area of chemistry. I've been doing this for 17 years now, and I literally could retire today, but that would be boring. And I enjoy teaching and I enjoy this field, and I want to see it be exposed to other people, young people, who have an opportunity to see what it's all about, because I didn't have that opportunity. I didn't know about essential oils until after I got out of grad school. The term wasn't even ever exposed to me. And that's, as I was telling the class, is because Europe is way ahead of the United States in this area. It's just never kind of blossomed like it did there. But it's changing, and hopefully classes like this will kind of catch on and other people will start doing it. So any questions before I move to actual, to get started in some of this material?
So we could still be in biochem at the same time?
I told Elaine that I would be open to starting later. It's up to them. Whether, I don't know if other people might, you know, because then we're getting into a little bit later time. How late are you going to have to be?
6:30. I think we said 6:30.
The good thing is, and I will give you access, the reason we're videotaping this is partly for that reason, and partly because there are people taking a home study version of this course. So the whole lecture is going to be video recorded, and you'll be able to watch it on YouTube. So the part you miss, you can catch up with on there. So I don't think you're going to be hurt too bad if you have to miss that first half hour. Going to be plenty of time after. I mean, it's a 3-hour course. So, and if you're going to miss the first parts, of probably the best, because, you know, you're getting settled in. We're just kind of reintroducing things, getting back into things. So I think you'll be fine if we can't do it. Any other questions? Okay. Let's talk about just a brief history of aromatics. I'm not a big history person, but some of these things are useful and helpful to know about where all this comes from, because there's a lot of myths out there in the field of essential oils and people who are into the aromatherapy field that you are going to be exposed to if you go further with this. And if you know some history, you'll be able to rebuff a lot of that. All right. So we're going to start with prehistoric times. The way things kind of evolved, prehistory, trial and error discoveries of the healing powers of certain herbs, roots, and juices. Fragrant plant materials were used as external applications for wound and skin conditions. In most of these early cultures, ritual and therapeutic roles were intertwined. The early cave dweller probably associated certain sensations or emotional states with particular varieties of wood used in campfires and might possibly have linked these effects with spirituality. Back then, there was no such thing as an essential oil yet. This is a, for title, a brief history of aromatics. Okay, then about, say, 3000 BC, come the Egyptians. The Egyptians began the arts of massage, reflexology, early forms of cosmetology, aromatic medicine, perfumery, and pharmacy all emerged from this culture. Healer priests use oils, incense, inhalations, massage blends, ointments, and internal herbal remedies. They used enfleurage. Anybody ever heard that term, enfleurage? It's a method of extracting aromatics from plants using fatty oil. Okay, that's a, you're gonna hear that term in this industry occasionally. Fatty oils like olive oil, that kind of thing. So basically they would take the plant, flower, whatever it would be, and macerate it. Soak it in this vegetable oil, and that the odor would impart itself onto this fatty oil.
Mm-hmm. Did they use animal
lard? That's a good question. They could have. I would expect that they probably did, but that would be a little bit more difficult than using plants, obviously. But. Yeah, the enfleurage technique. Anybody ever seen the movie? I think it's called Perfumery. It was out, I don't know, between five and ten years ago. Dustin Hoffman was in it, had a brief role in it. Interesting movie. The perfumer in that basically did both, I believe he did an enfleurage and distillation of dead women. You seen it? Uh-huh. Yeah, he would. He would take, capture like hookers and whatnot.
Perfume in America.
Pardon?
So I think it was just called perfume.
Yeah, perfume. That's right, perfume. So he would get these women and then distill them down to their essence, you know. Of course, they would die in the process. But he created this magical elixir that would basically make people fall instantly in love with the person wearing it or whatnot. Pretty interesting movie. Some interesting factual stuff there around the background of perfumery. So that's why it's interesting from that perspective. But anyway, so entourage, remember that term. The Egyptians also embalmed mummies with blends of aromatic spices, gums of cassia, myrrh, and cedarwood. I hope I don't run out of marker here. Embalming of mummies. Spices and herbs. Typically things like cassia, myrrh, cedarwood. A blend called kaifi. Was made by the priest, which contained a calamus root. It was used as incense, perfume, or taken internally as medicine. Calamus contains a toxic chemical called acerone, which has been shown to have hallucinogenic properties. The historian Plutarch said kaifi lulls to sleep, allays anxieties, brightens dreams. Cleopatra, the last of the Egyptian queens, was said to be a lavish user of perfumes. I think some of this stuff, I'm running out of ink, would probably be also expounded upon in the book. But again, this is a, thank you, this is a chemistry course, not a history course. But I don't want to say forget all this stuff, because, you know, some of the things that I really hit upon might be on a test, but not going to overwhelm you with this kind of stuff.
Question, would you be a book for this class, slash the bookstore today?
Yeah, it's not in yet. The bookstore...
It's not.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay, well, if you want the book, you can buy it on Amazon. It's The Chemistry of Essential Oils by David G. Williams. It's in the syllabus. I've seen it as low as $40. But I don't know if it's available for that right now. Used?
Barnes & Noble has it for like $70, whereas Amazon has it listed as like $200-something.
Yeah, I think I saw one. I think people are starting to snatch it up all over the country because they know that I'm using it. So, but again, if you don't want to spend the money on it, I understand. I think you'll be able to do fine without it, but I think it would be useful for you to have it if you have an interest. And I was my understanding that I had to have a textbook with the course. So eventually I'm going to have my own textbook, which we can boil things. But this is good. It's a good textbook, and it's written for people that are non-chemistry. So it's pretty easy read, and there's a lot of, I mean, the chemistry you're going to, you know, think's easy, but there's a lot of other stuff in there that would be useful for you to know. Okay, that brings us to the Chinese culture. Around 2700 BC. heard of ancient Chinese secret? Well, the ancient Chinese herbal tradition. This is still, you know, people who research and practice this kind of tradition. It accompanied the practice of acupuncture. There's people out there who swear by this. I mean, they live this stuff, and it's an alternative form of medicine for them. Around 2700 BC, Huang Ti wrote the Yellow Emperor's classic of internal medicine. Among many remedies they used were calamus, rose, camphor, chamomile, opium, and ginger. Then around 2000 BC, we have the Ayurvedic or Indian culture. Anybody ever heard that term, Ayurveda? Another term you will hear among a lot of people who are in the alternative healing fields of aromatherapy and herbal medicine, that kind of stuff. Ayurveda is a very big, big deal to them. As the physicians of the information from religion, they began writing it down. The Vedas, one of the oldest sacred books, contained the first written formulas. The Rig Veda codified the religious and healing uses of over 700 substances. Including cinnamon, spikenard, ginger, myrrh, coriander, and sandalwood. The Ayurvedic medicine system is one of the oldest forms of medicine practiced by man and has made a comeback in today's natural therapies. Brings us to biblical references. Now, the reason I'm covering some of this history is because you're going to hear people, if you become more entrenched in this online and so forth, you'll hear people refer to essential oils being used all the way back in biblical times. Okay, but that's not true. Essential oils did not exist back then because no one had discovered steam distillation yet. So when they talk about oils of biblical times, really what they would be referring to would be extracted products like enfleurage type things, crude solvent extraction type things, not distillation. And that's the way an essential oil is defined today, involves steam distillation. And we haven't really defined an essential oil yet, but we should probably do that. And basically, an essential oil is a steam distilled oil. It's not really an oil. It's aromatic. It's an aromatic isolate of steam distilled plant. Okay, it could be it's steam distilled, or else it's in the case of citrus, it's pressed, cold pressed. That's the only one that's exception. That's also called an essential oil, or the citrus peel oils. They don't steam distill those. Usually, there are some exceptions, but most of them are cold pressed. So, by and large, when you use the term essential oil, you are referring almost primarily to a steam distilled product. Now, you chemistry majors have probably never experienced the process of steam distillation. We will be doing that in here. I'll be doing a demo of it. You'll get to see firsthand what it involves, but it's not like a fractional distillation or anything like that. Basically, you're using water or steam to you have a container that would have your biomass, a very large container on a production scale, that steam would be injected into this, rise up through the biomass, and then you're going to come into, it's a very simple procedure, really, condenser. Now the steam lifts out the organic components, the volatile organic components from the plant. Not all plants have these. You can't steam distill anything, but the ones who have essential oils can be steam distilled. And the steam will lift that those volatile organics out. If you've had any physical chemistry, it's basically a vapor point depression of two immiscible, because these are immiscible layers at the end. You know, these essential oils are not soluble in water. Pure essential oils are gonna would boil at over 200 degrees Celsius, but they can come over at 100 degrees Celsius through steam distillation. Okay, so steam rises through this, goes through the condenser. The oil and water, gaseous oil and water, are condensed and then collected in some kind of receiver, separator. And the oil typically floats on top of the water, and then the water can be drained off. That's your hydrosol. So you got water with a very thin layer of oil, typically. The yields are typically 1% or less. Based upon the mass of material you put here, the amount of oil you're going to get over here is typically 1% or less. That's why a lot of them are so expensive.
Is that 1% yield based on what you could get, or is that just 1% of what you collect?
It's 1%, let's say you put in 100 kilos of biomass here, you get 1 kilo of oil out.
Is the does it use a sock slot extractor, is that different?
No. Now, there are setups that people do, you know, in industry, come up ways to do things like that. But traditional steam distillation is just this very simple. And you just basically separate the water, which is called the hydrosol, and that can be sold as another product. You may have heard of lavender water or rose water. Rose water especially is a very widely used commercial product. These hydrosols can be used as spritzers. People spray their linens or their face or whatever. It's a very a very good way for them to get rid of their wastewater, really. It's found another marketing product, but some of it actually has some therapeutic use. Sandalwood, hydrosol, for example, is found to be very therapeutic. It has some very good therapeutic aspects to it. But no, this is it. Very simple. And you'll see it firsthand. So this process had not been discovered yet. So if anybody ever talks about essential oils in biblical times, they're basically full crap because it had not been discovered. So what we have here in the biblical times, or according to Exodus, we have Moses. And I meant to bring this, but Moses had a blend, which is actually formula. I mean, the actual formula, specific formula for Moses' anointing oil is in Exodus. I think it's chapter 31. We have recreated this blend using essential oils. It wouldn't be the way they did it, but we've created the same proportional blend using essential oils, which involves things like cassia, calamus, myrrh, frankincense, did I say that? Anyway, they would use this as an anointing for like a temple, things like that. And also another blend was used to consecrate men into priesthood. Myrrh was used in the purification of Jewish women. From the New Testament, we have accounts of frankincense and myrrh. Of course, you probably know that story with the birth of Jesus and the three wise men bringing gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Frankincense and myrrh are two products that would produce an essential oil, but they did not present Jesus with myrrh and frankincense oil. It would have been the actual resin, which is valued as gold in those days. And then you have the story of Mary Magdalene anointing the feet of Jesus with spikenard. It's another essential oil, but they would have made it through some kind of extraction process back then. Many references to aromatic oils are mentioned in the Bible, but these are herbal infusions, macerations, not distilled oils. Okay. This brings us to the Greeks. By the way, if you haven't figured out, Pappas is Greek. Don't be discriminating against me because of that. They built on the knowledge of the Egyptians. In, let's say about 500 BC on. Built on the Egyptian. And in about 78 AD, we have the Greek surgeon Dioscorides wrote his 5-volume herbal book called Materia Medica. Which he described the properties of about 600 plants from the Mediterranean region that were known to have medicinal properties. Th- this book was a major event in the development of medicine, as it became the standard medical text for the next 1,000 years. The aromatic section covered aromatic ointments and massage oils. For example, Phoenician juniper was used as a spermicide. Don't ask me if that burned or not. Hippocrates is known as the father of holistic medicine. He recommended daily scented bath and massage. He also prescribed perfume fumigations. Lesbos, in his work called Concerning Odors, gave many physical and emotional effects with the use of fragrance. That brings us to the Romans. They further sophisticated the Egyptian and Greek medical principles, applied more decadent and lavish use of aromatics with the addition of a series of baths with massage, characteristic of Romans. Getting into the decadence of things. Galen in about 131 to 200 AD was a Greek pharmacist. /physician, lived in Rome and compiled his knowledge on preparing formulas containing plant and animal drugs into about 20 books. The term galenical pharmacy is a tribute to his accuracy in recording his observations. To about 800 AD in the Arabs. And Al-Kindi, also known as Al-Hindi. He wrote a volume called The Book on Chemistry of Perfumes and Distillation. This is where we get into the discovery of distillation. Avicenna Anybody ever heard of Avicenna? Anyone heard that name? 980 to 1037. He's the one who's credited with the invention of true distillation. Okay? Credited with it. But evidence of more primitive forms have been found that predate him. He was known as the Great Physician. He's credited with the invention of the refrigerated coil and wrote the Canon of Medicine, a standard text until the mid-16th century. Now's where it starts to get a little more interesting. So from 500 to say 1300 AD, we got the Middle Ages. And we've all heard the term the alchemist, right? Everyone knows that term. What are the alchemists known for?
Lead poisoning.
Lead poisoning. Okay. Exactly. That's usually the most common thing that people associate with the alchemist. But the alchemist, huh?
No. Philosopher's Stone.
Philosopher's Stone, that's right. But it was more, their area of science, if you want to call it that, was more than just about trying to turn lead into gold. In their searching for the elixir of life and the Philosopher's Stone, they made many chemical discoveries. Their system basically believed in four basic elements. Anybody might know what those were?
Earth, air, fire, water.
Yeah. Earth. Let's see if I put them in the right order here. Now, don't worry about the order. Earth, air, fire, water. They believed that those comprise the basis of just about everything. But, you know, they discovered distillation. And when, you know, they did that, they started distilling everything. So when they hit upon a plant that happened to have an essential oil in it, and they got this layer of this liquid floating on top of the water, they thought that they had discovered the fifth element. Which they termed the quintessential, or the quintessence, the fifth element. And basically anything that didn't dissolve in water was considered an oil. So that's why they called it an oil. And the quintessence, that's where the term essential oil comes from. This is important to know. As it comes from the discovery of the quintessence which was thought to be oil because it was insoluble in water. So if you ever hear anyone say that the term, they're called essential oils because they're essential to the plant, or they're the life's blood of the plant, swiftly rebuke them and send them on their way after you educate them. You will hear that. There are some multi-level marketing groups out there who train their minions to spout out this kind of nonsense because it sounds good. The oil is the life's blood of the plant, and that's why it's going to give you new life and cure your cancer and blindness and everything else. Okay? But the essential oil, the term comes from the fact that it was thought to be an oil because it didn't dissolve in water, and the alchemists thought they had discovered the fifth element or the quintessence. Well, the term just kind of evolved to the essential oil, stuck to this day. Even though it's not an element and it's not an oil. And the reason it's not, okay, debunk. It's the reason it's not the life blood of the plant. Is because these things are, if you're going to do an analogy, a human analogy, the oil doesn't function anything like blood does in a human. What's the function of blood in the human body? You know all this stuff. Transport. What is the function of the essential oil? Well, it's really a, it's a, essential oils are secondary metabolites of the plant. They are end products of the metabolism of the plant. They're waste products. That doesn't mean they're not useful to the plant or to us, but that's what they are. They come out, they're a result of the plant having a metabolism. So they're more analogous to perhaps sweat or urine or something like that. Not as glamorous as the life's blood of the plant. Try to market it as the piss of the plant, you're not going to get very far. So they had to come up with some other, I don't know if the person who, I know who originated this, and I don't know if they're just ignorant or conniving, but either way, it's wrong. And whenever people say this, when I hear these reps say this, it's like chalkboard, like fingernails on a chalkboard to me. We have to dispel this. And I'm doing that on my Facebook page. It's got over 2,000 people now that follow it. So hopefully we can dispel this myth after decades, literally decades of people spouting this nonsense. It's hard to kill this kind of stuff. So they are, what is their function? Now I'm getting off on a tangent here because we're still in history, but the function of these secondary metabolites, they're secondary metabolites, that doesn't mean they're not useful or they don't serve a purpose, but they're mainly to attract pollinators. It's one function they serve. Resist disease or repel predators who would eat them. You know, you eat this leaf and it's got an essential oil in it and the animal wants to spit it out because it tastes nasty. It's a protective mechanism. So they are useful to the plant and they are useful to humans, but we don't need to glamorize it and call it the lifeblood of the plant and all this kind of stuff. Okay. I digress. This brings us to the 15th century, the Renaissance. I'm going to go through this a little quicker now. Where are we at? Oh, okay. Between 60 and 70 essences now became well known. So this is mainly now in Europe where this is all developing. So this is why Europe's, you know, this is such a much more normal part of European culture because they have a long history in it. So they're, I mean, we're talking the 1500s. They're using essential oils, the same oils that we use today.
So just to be clear, so in the Middle Ages, when the alchemists did the distillation, that is when they were actually became essential oils.
Well, that's not when they were first. Remember, Avicenna is credited prior to that as being officially the person who discovered true distillation. But the alchemists are the ones who, you know, and they didn't know who Avicenna was. They're over here at a later time doing their own thing. They discovered distillation and then thought they discovered the fifth element. And that's when it became really more commonplace to do these distillations. That sparked it all. So then we go to the 16th century. And we have aromatic waters and chemical oils. Could be bought from local apothecary shops. Most of the useful essential oils have been discovered near the end of the 16th and beginning of the 17th century. Printing press was invented, leading to the spread of knowledge throughout Europe. Then we have the great herbal. In 1526, in which a guy by the name of, and I'm not going to ask you to remember this, Hieronymus Braunschweig. He was a physician / alchemist, wrote on distillation and surgery. His last book was written about 1597 and referred to 25 different essential oils. Now, I should have mentioned that during the Dark Ages, I don't know why I didn't put this in here, but during the period of the bubonic plague, which was, what, anybody know that off the top of their head, what the years were for the bubonic plague? I should have put that in here. I don't want to give you inaccurate information. Hmm?
6th and 7th century.
Yes, that's what I was thinking. 6th, 7th century. So just make a note during the bubonic dark. Is that, that's the Dark Age? That's considered Dark Age.
Black Death went through Europe in the 14th century.
14th century. Is that important? Well, this is really a testament to the power of some of these oils. You know, people are dying everywhere, bubonic plague. They realize that somehow this is contagious. So these thieves get an idea that, you know, they know that these herbs have medicinal properties, they have protection properties, whatever. So these thieves get the idea, we're going to cover ourselves in herb extracts, herb itself, herb rubs, whatever, things like rosemary, thyme, eucalyptus, things like that, cinnamon, so that we can protect ourselves while we go rob dead bodies. And it worked. So they actually were able to do this and not catch the bubonic plague. It actually did protect them. And so from that experience is why there's a people talk about the Four Thieves blend. If you look that up online, you'll learn more about that. And this blend is used today to, it's versions of it are actually used in hospitals to protect against airborne bacteria, things like that. It's a very antiseptic blend. So that's where that term comes from. It's not very appealing, but that's what it is.
So it prevents flea bites.
Flea bites?
Yeah, that's what spreads the plague.
Oh.
That or inhibits your sending pestis, which is the vector for it.
Can't you catch the bubonic plague from another person?
No, that's a pneumonic plague.
Oh, okay.
Bubonic plague is mostly spread by fleas,
okay.
Rats.
All right. I'm not a virologist or whatever.
There's no anti-flea shampoo. It smells like peppermint, lavender, and all sorts of crap.
Okay. So yes, apparently the blend did protect them from getting bitten.
Hey, I have lavender on my dog that's never been on flea and tick medicine. She's never had one.
Yes, and there are essential oils. One in particular that I can tell you, catnip oil that will protect you from getting bit by mosquitoes. Probably the most insect repellent oil there is. It was tested and found to be 10 times more effective than DEET at a 1% concentration, because it has a unique component in it called nepetalactone that is actually a pheromone to the mosquito that signals the mosquito to stay away. Different mechanism than some of the other claimed essential oils like citronella and so forth, who really don't do anything in terms of repellency. What they do is mask CO2, and that's what the mosquitoes are attracted to, is the CO2 in your breath. And so these other concoctions that don't really work, all they do is really interfere with that. So in some way, I guess they do work, but they're not a repellent. You'll still get bit if you have those things on. I've never been bit in wearing a catnip solution, but it smells like, you know, it smells horrible. So you have to mix it with other things to make it appealing to people. Also repels, yeah. Also, what you do is, there's actually blends out there called Deep Buster and other blends that incorporate the catnip with other oils to make it smell nice in a solution of a carrier that allows you to just put it on like suntan lotion. And it will protect you for several hours.
Which one have cats on? I have a cat, he would love me if
I. Some cat. Now that's an unusual, I mean, odd thing, because we did experiment with that. We used to have a cat, and The cat would, some cats would just, it was like a drug to them. They would smell it and it would be like, oh, they'd be back. And just be like, yeah, man, I'm wasted. And then other cats would smell it and they would just go crazy. I mean, they would attack you, just weird stuff. And then some cats would just do nothing. It didn't affect them at all. So, I guess there's a gene for that in the cat, whether it's affected by catnip. Yeah, it's like weed for cats. All right, this brings us to the 17th and 18th centuries. We saw the beginnings of the common use of essential oils and aromatics for health. The return of the bubonic plague increased the demand for aromatics. Large-scale fumigation began, and wood was burned in the streets to ward off spirits and to cover stench. Incense and candles were floors were strewn with herbs. The connection between aromatics and health was firmly established. Evidence supporting this belief was found later in the 19th century when perfumers showed almost complete immunity during cholera outbreaks. So, just know this is when we really had common use among everyday people of essential oils. For medicinal purposes.
Whenever you say aromatic, you mean like...
I know what you're going to say. And we will get to that in the first section when we cover hydrocarbons. When I'm saying aromatic, I will specify when I mean chemical aromaticity versus... Most of the time I'm going to be talking about aromatic, meaning it smells. Okay, which doesn't mean that in chemistry. So for those people with no chemical background who will be watching this video or whatever, that's something that needs to be noted, and we'll expound on that more later.
Because this information is only useful when talking about the plague, is everyone familiar with the child's song Ring Around the Rosie and how it pertains to the plague? With a pocket full of posies, was probably a reference to either actual flowers or incense.
Right.
Stench of dead bodies.
Yeah, that's right. All right, now, 19th century. I'm getting close to being done here. Just bear with me. So this is when perfumery broke from the business of apothecary and became firmly established on its own. So, you know, time's getting a little bit better. People are enjoying a little more luxuries. The art of perfumery is developing, and people are using these things as just purely for aesthetic reasons, not for health. So, the area around Grasse in southern France. Became a major center for the cultivation and extraction of essences for perfumery. Today, this area is still considered the Mecca of perfumery. Anybody ever been to France? Yeah. Ever been to Grasse?
No, yeah. I don't remember what I was there.
Well, if you ever do go to France and you have a chance, that's a region that you want to check out. Not only is it beautiful, but it's just a rich area of history. And especially if you have any interest in all in this field, you'll want to visit that area. See the beautiful lavender fields, things like that, the distilleries and things like that. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, we went to the wine, the big place that had all the wine. When we go up there, we didn't see much of color, anything more than I have not been there.
Right. Cool. So yeah, this is also by the this area and French lavender in particular is really what ultimately led to sort of the birth of modern aromatherapy, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But during this period of time in the 1800s, large-scale production had commenced and grew into massive businesses, employing tens of thousands, growing and processing aromatic plants. The most predominant essential oils coming out of this region are lavandin and lavender. To this day, French lavender is known as the finest in the world. Now, don't say that to a Bulgarian, but still known as the, one of the finest. That's an arguable point. Although it's true, unadulterated French lavender is rarely seen by anyone outside of France. So it's, and that's because of the advent of Bulgaria now in the world, seen as one of the major, the major producer of lavender oil. A lot of French lavender ends up being cut with Bulgarian lavender. Not that Bulgarian's bad or anything, but that's what happens. France cannot produce the demand, the world demand of lavender oil. And so there's actually more lavender sold out of France than is produced in France. So that tells you something else is going on there. Brings us to the 20th century. By this time, essential oils were commonly used in medicine up until the 1950s, after which they became more established for the use in flavor, fragrance, and the cosmetic industries. So that's really two things, since America is a relatively young country, another contributing fact why essential oils aren't so used. By the time America really got rocking and rolling, technology had advanced, medicine had advanced, people became less reliant on these things for health, more reliant on modern medicine, and these things were just, you know, things to make you smell good. You know. Which in a way is a shame because a lot of it is still useful. The chemical analysis of plants and essences goes back well over 100 years. Yet in spite of this body of research, use of essential oils for medicinal purposes has undergone a period of neglect from mainstream medicine, from which they are now starting to reemerge. Here's some of the key people who have contributed to the establishment of therapeutic use of essential oils in the 20th century. You have Gattafossi, depending on how you pronounce it. 1928, René Gattafossi. This is a name you should really be familiar with because this guy really is credited with sort of the modern aromatherapy. He actually coined the term aromatherapy. He's a French perfumer and chemist. And then in his course of working in the lab, anybody know this story? heard about this? No? Okay. It's pretty well known. He had an explosion, right? And he was badly burned. And when you're a perfumer in a lab and you're on fire and you just are looking for the nearest thing to soothe yourself, you're going to put yourself, your hands or whatever, into the nearest vat of liquid that you can find. And that happened to be a vat of lavender. So he was surprised after that at the phenomenal rate of healing that occurred with no sign of infection or scar. So the guy's burning, puts his hands in lavender, a burn that would normally be a pretty bad scar and take a long time to heal, healed up quicker and left very little scarring. Or actually, according to this, no sign of infection or scar. He published a book showing the use of essential oils as antiseptic and antibacterial agents for skin care and coined the term aromatherapy. Spelled with an IE. Which he defined as a therapy employing aromatics in a sphere of research opening enormous vistas to those who have started exploring it. Pretty significant event in the history of aromatics. Besides inventing the term aromatherapy, he also pointed the direction at the use of whole essential oils rather than fractionated ones. Because this is when perfumery was going on in France. Largely, your ingredients back then were natural essential oils. They hadn't developed synthetic chemistry to the point at which those ingredients were used very much in perfumery. It's the opposite of that of today. Pretty much every cologne that you would go to buy at department store or perfume is going to be almost all synthetics with very little naturals, and that's because the naturals are a lot more expensive, but still used and still necessary, because you can't recreate some of these oils, or any of these oils. You cannot completely recreate them in a lab, and we'll talk about why that is a little later. So he found that many of the essential oils were effective at antimicrobial activity than their individual isolated components. And they were doing these individual isolated, they would take a whole oil, vacuum distill off components, and use those for their perfume blends because, you know, they had desirable aromatic profiles compared to the whole oil. And that was a lot of perfumery back then, but he realized that these individual isolated components did not have as beneficial therapeutic effect as the whole oil. He found that many essential oils were more effective at antimicrobial activity than their individual isolated components. This echoed the findings of Cuthbert Hall's 1904 study that showed antiseptic power of eucalyptus oil was stronger than that of its main component 1,8-cineol, which is also called eucalyptol. And that is like 80% of eucalyptus oil. So you got a component, it's called 1,8-cineol, used to be called eucalyptol, still referred to that today, but most people in the industry call it 1,8-cineol. That component makes up 80% or more of eucalyptus oil, and yet the eucalyptus oil was found to be more therapeutically beneficial than just that component. Significantly so. So now we come to 1954, and Dr. Jean Valnet who is a French doctor and scientist, established doses of essential oils to be used in treating various medical and psychiatric disorders. The results of his research were published in the book Practice of Aromatherapy. 1964. Valnet, who is still alive, at least at the time of this writing, so I don't know, has his own product line of essential oils and is affiliated with Aveda. Ever heard of Aveda Corporation in the United States? Anybody ever heard of them? This is where the French tradition of aromatherapy sort of got its base, was through Valnet. And that's why you'll hear people talk about the French tradition, which is more, encompasses more oral use of the essential oils, as opposed to the English tradition, which encompasses more therapeutic massage, where they would encompass, they would blend the essential oil in a vegetable oil base, and then use that on the body to through skin absorption and things like that. That's more the British model versus the French model, which is more ingestion. And in the USA, I would say it's probably more inhalation. But you get pockets of people doing everything here. Okay, then in 1964, another important person is Marguerite Mari. Was a biochemist. And studied the work of Valnet and wrote The Secret of Life and Youth. Applying Valnet's research to her beauty therapy, she combined essential oils and massage, considering how a person is feeling emotionally and physically, as the basis for her holistic therapy. She conceived the notion of the individual prescription, or IP, blend to operate on a physical, psychological, spiritual level to normalize the unbalanced function of the whole person. It's kind of giving rise to the whole modern holistic therapy, holistic medicine.
Osteopath?
Yeah,
is that kind of the same?
That would be more, even more traditional than this, I think. This when you talk holistic, we're talking about we're treating the person, not the symptoms. Okay, that's the approach of, you know, getting a whole personality profile, history on the person, figuring out what is going to work best for them on multiple levels, i.e., aromatherapy, herbal therapy, massage therapy, acupuncture, could be reflexology, all of this stuff. Okay, all these alternative healing modalities to treat the person and not the illness. Today in America, essential oils are widely used in flavors and fragrances. Recently, there seems to be a revival of their use for therapeutic purposes as people search for alternatives to traditional medicine. Aromatherapy in the U.S. is mainly practiced by massage and beauty therapists and other holistic practitioners, with increasing interest among doctors and nurses. Hospitals are now devoting entire divisions to alternative medicine, of which aromatherapy is becoming a significant part. Currently, there is no certification available nationally for aromatherapy, but efforts are currently underway to achieve this goal. The primary organization leading the way for the establishment of educational professional standards is NAHA, or the National Association for Holistic Aromatherapists. So, you know, there is this movement now, and I think you're going to see this this movement increase in popularity, especially in this time of the latest healthcare regulation, as more and more as doctors basically get dumbed down to human technicians, and more doctors who are really good leave the field or else stop taking Medicare because they can't. They're forced to take these huge cuts in what they can take. So I think people are going to be more reliant upon these other methods because going to the doctor is going to be less and less beneficial. They'll have the illusion of healthcare, but it will not be like it, you know, traditionally has been. And we've already seen this to start to happen. Which in some ways I think might be good for people to get reintroduced to these things and take charge of their own health. Because even if you don't believe any of this stuff works, the person is now taking charge of their own health in a way that they weren't before. And I can guarantee you some of it does work. So at least it gets them off the mentality that it's out of their control. They have to be relying on doctors all the time. And go to the doctor. Yeah, go to the doctor. I got a headache. I feel like I'm getting the flu. Go to the doctor. You know, that's a lot of people have that mentality nowadays. But if you could take charge of some of this on your own and use alternative methods, I think that can only be a good thing in the long run for a lot of people. Yes, I think it is. Any questions before we go for a break? Okay. Let's take a 15-minute break and we'll actually start talking chemistry.